making handcrafted wines, one wine at a time. Mulberry Vineyards, located in historic Chepachet, Rhode Island.
Hi, my name's Walter Steer, president of the Glocester Town Council. Welcome to our town.
Glocester, Rhode Island is nestled in the northwest corner of the state near the Connecticut border. The town itself is rather large, almost 57 square miles with 10,000 residents. Yet it maintains a small, quaint feel. Glocester is a community steeped in tradition. Townspeople there recognize the role of teaching standards and values from one generation to the next. And while the town continues to grow with new businesses and folks who would like to call it home, it preserves the small town culture. Your friends and neighbors welcome you to our town, Glocester.
The Indians, you must understand, when they named a place, they wanted to make certain that any stranger coming to that place would recognize what it was. The Indian name for Chepachet means where Father Sky's cloud streams divide. We've seen it for years. I'm a native here. My grandmother was a midwife here. Many people, even only 6 years, summer residents, have seen it happen, where the clouds will go around us. That is because of the summer winds. We have two hills west of us that split the clouds. And there it is, Father Sky's cloud streams divide, Chepachet. This is a quiet country town that everyone wants to drive through. This is a part of the early turnpike system. And the turnpike system came from this side of the bridge, the north side of the bridge, all the way to Connecticut boundary. It was called West Gloucester Turnpike, and it did have tolls on it. And it was the first commercial toll road in the country, and one of the last, if not the last, to exist. And we're still traveling that same road. As a matter of fact, that same road is the Great Wilderness Path that the Indians took coming out from Plymouth, Massachusetts, all the way through Seekonk, Providence, all the way through Chepachet and on to Hartford Falls on the Connecticut River. And gradually that opened up. But it is still the same wilderness path. The population continued west as far as they dared. Now, I mean by that, the Massachusetts Bay Colony up here in Massachusetts were very, very strict. The Connecticut people were very strict. But Rhode Island was bastion of religious liberty. and they could come here and feel confident. They could come here from the Cape, they could come here from the Plymouth colony, and they could stay here. They felt comfortable. As a consequence, many families stayed for several generations. The upshot of that was, people now coming from all over the country are looking toward people in Rhode Island to answer some of their questions about their ancestry. And I get a lot of that. In some cases, actually take people to their ancestral homes or the site of their ancestral home. It's enriching both to me and to them too. They're thrilled. It was a 27-room building. It lasted for just 100 years. It was burned in 1913. And certainly there was all manner of things going on there, not all at once, but over the years. It was the largest of our hotels. And certainly it had dance classes. It had the Catholic Church, the Episcopal Church meetings there. 100-horse stall that was adjacent to it, so people could come for miles around and feel comfortable that their animals were safe, well-fed, and undercover. Chepachet Hotel burned in 1913. We had no fire-fighting apparatus at that time. Everyone was grabbing whatever was wet out the door went to fight the fire. Well, that didn't work. That is only the beginning, because our mills burned one after another as well here. So the huge White's Mill that was here on Tanyard Lane, just down at the end of Tanyard Lane, is 4 and 5 stories high. It served to employ about 300 workers, and that burned in 1897. So you see, you know, it was one thing right after another. Then in 1907, we had a fire that started at one of the stores in town, at the back of the store. And before they knew it, there were the store, the barn behind it, the house next to it, everything was going, and it was pushed by a wind from the north, and it just continued to engulf houses as it went. And fortunately, the wind did turn so that we do have some that are left, and that really tore the heart right out of that area completely, altogether changed. Chepachet was only a part of it. And we had little hamlets throughout Gloucester. There's Williams Mills and Clarkville. Harmony has had its own little hamlet, a dear little chapel there with a barrel ceiling. They have a wonderful library and certainly an extremely active fire department.
In past history, we have learned over the years of the fires that we did have in the town of Gloucester. Many of them were due to the construction of the homes. The construction of the homes here in the town of Gloucester vary. They vary in age. They vary in sizes, but they also vary from the old style of the farmhouse when years ago that there was a lot of farming here in the town of Gloucester, to the new construction of the homes. Some of the homes do date back to the early 1900s, and then here we are today to the present of the homes just built recently here in 2014. Many of them were due to the construction of the homes, but also to do with different ways they were using to heat their homes. Back when they were using wood and coal to heat their homes, we have went through the history, and the records show that many fires occurred because of that. One of the ways that they would keep track of what was going on and the calls that they would respond to in the alarm. So this is back in February 25th, 1953, at 11:30, how they responded to recorded alarm of a fire. And it came in through what they used back then was a red phone. People used to dial in, and there was a red phone that was kept in a house across the street. And this woman would answer the phone, and then she would alert the fire people that lived within the village by blowing the siren on the roof and tell them to respond to whatever the need or whether the emergency was back then. And this is what trucks responded. This is how many men came. And this is the gentleman that was back in charge. And then if you see the word secure, that's what time they got back.
at 12:35. This is May 26, 1957. Same thing where they had an alarm. Is Greenville had a house fire and how they responded, and this is how many trucks that they had there, a number of men, and this is when they got back at 5:55, and these are the people that responded back then.
But today, people being more safety-minded and the building construction codes being more stringent, that we have reduced our fire loss, and we're proud to say that fire and life loss here in the town of Gloucester. One of the bigger demands that has come forward to the fire service in the town of Gloucester here in the Harmony Fire District is the EMS services. EMS services are a big demand here to the fire service with day-to-day requests for 911 calls. Some of the challenges that we have here in the Harmony Fire District today is keeping up and keeping up with the demands. The schooling is a big demand, and these people do volunteer their time. Where the education process, just to be, to put it distinctly, just to step on into the back of that rescue, it's just about a year of education that these people have to do before they even step into the back of that rescue to provide that EMS service. And then along with another 6 months of firefighter training. The location of Harmony Fire Station is as you enter into the town of Gloucester, it's one of the first buildings that you do see. So as is a good location, and it really, the only negative impact that it does have, that our Route 44 has become a busier road as the traffic and the population grows.
You can see how the building has grown though since 1924, where we started with the original right there underneath the Harmony Fire Department sign, the original three bays, and then as the building has grown. This is the Christmas tree that we light every year. It's a tradition that we do with the children in the community, and we bring Santa in to start off the holiday season.
This is a real traditional thing. This is a picture that was given to me, and actually what it shows is way back. It has always been a tradition here at the Harmony Fire Department. And it's usually always the first Sunday after Thanksgiving that Santa comes to the fire station, and it brings gifts for the children within the community. And I'm proud to say that here it is in 2014, and we've been holding this tradition up for many, many, many years, where the members of this department collect funds in order to purchase gifts so that we can give to the children within the community. Santa comes on this fire truck every single year. We provide some sort of an entertainment for them every single year. And it's a good time. It's a really, really good time. And it shows a little bit about the family and how we like to give back to the community, not only with fire and EMS services, but also give to the community in any way and fashion that we can.
My name is Thomas D'Agostino, and I'm a paranormal researcher, historian, author, and investigator. Chepachia is very intriguing to me because of its history. It is so much history that still exists there that has not been, I guess, crushed by the wheels of progress. Obviously, we're not the only ones who love Chepachia, because many people have stayed behind long after their tenure on this earth to remain in that wonderful little section of town. Chepachia is not only several buildings are haunted, but one building in particular, the Tavern on Main, or the Stagecoach Tavern, as a lot of people still remember it, is probably the most haunted building in the state of Rhode Island. The Tavern on the Main has a very, very illustrious history. First of all, we have the house being built in 1760, then turned into a tavern in 1799. Where countless travelers would stop and, you know, have a meal while they exchanged horses, stay the night. Also, it was the scene of the Door Rebellion in 1842. You have a ripe situation for a haunting. And I came across the ideas of it being haunted because I used to live near there, and we used to stop by there every so often, and the owner found out that I was a paranormal investigator and started telling me stories. And we found some wild stuff going on there right then and there. And ever since then, we have frequently received calls, emails, and other kinds of media of people who have had experiences there. In fact, every time we mention the tavern, somebody has something to say about something that has happened there in the paranormal sense. During the investigation, we were, the EMF meters and different meters we were using were telling nothing more than the place, different areas where there was a lot of wiring or a lot of electrical frequencies. As we finished our investigation, or we thought we did, Arlene went to sit in the tap room with a friend, and they were sitting next to a bunch of wine glasses, I guess, and they were talking about Catholic school and religion. And one of them said something as I'm walking by, and I made a kind of a quick laugh about it, and one of the glasses exploded into like a million pieces, not only all over them and me, but all over everybody in the area that was sitting near them. When we had it tested by a crystal expert, he said the only way that could have happened is if somebody came down on it with a hammer. Staff and patrons alike see the ghosts of the tavern.
I was bartending one night and the TV almost killed a big biker guy that I was friends with. He was laughing about the ghost and the TV came down, took a chunk of the floor and made this gentleman turn bright white and he was scared.
The next owner who had opened up the building and he said, oh, I opened up the building and there's a little boy standing in the dining room. And he called for the little boy because he was afraid someone had left their child there overnight. And worse, they weren't going to come claim him. And the little boy turned around and walked through the wall.
Just earlier this evening, a young lady told me about how her sweater was tugged at a low level as if it was a child tugging her sweater.
The little boy has been seen by many people.
The boy that a lot of people see around here. And he was very happy. He was talking to her. Because he was happy that he was wearing the white suit that he always wanted, that he was buried in, that he always wanted to wear for church. People see this little boy all the time.
Arlene was asking a question because somehow we got the idea that he may have gotten hurt.
Did you fall?
You hear giggling. You hear this little child go, did fall, and then you hear giggling for about 5-6 seconds. A man at the gas station one day was telling me that while the place was closed, and this was in 2007, in between owners, he went, his wife brings him lunch every day, and he went out to get his lunch, and he saw the little boy looking out the tap room window. And his wife did too, and they were staring at him. They're wondering, wow, this place is ice cold, it's been, the heat's off, the building has been closed down, and there's this little boy. So as she went to walk toward him, he just vanished. The way we speak, we push air. And our ears are designed to vibrate. And when they vibrate at different frequencies, which then, of course, makes us so we can hear this audio frequencies. And the microphones on a recorder do the same thing. They have a transducer that vibrates, and when it vibrates at a certain frequency, it turns them into electronic signals, and that's how we can replay what happened. Alice is a woman in the booth in the far corner. They used to call her Elizabeth. Not that there might be an Elizabeth there, but we, on two occasions, we received recordings that, when asking names, we got Alice. And one of them was from what people call a spirit box. We call it the cell phone to the dead. It was Thomas Edison's original invention on trying to speak to the dead and have them actually speak back to you, and you would hear it by having a radio go through frequencies.
Oh my God, Alice.
We're asking, what is your name? And I said, my name is Tom. What is your name? And clear as anything, going right over the frequencies, it says, my name's Alice.
Oh my God, Alice.
We are energy. And energy cannot be created or destroyed, it can only be transferred. But energy is also everything and all around us, from the air we breathe, which you can't see, to wind, which only makes itself visible when it pushes and moves objects, and yet that's energy also. So when people die or pass away, their energy could stay together, or it could be in the area that you are in that the energy is locked into and stays as a form. People should never be fearful of going to the tavern on the main for several reasons. One, the ghosts are friendly. And it's, you know, kind of exciting. You might see something really cool. Two, there's a lot of great people that go there, good company, and the food is incredible.
New school, Foster Gloucester.
Good day, my name is Thomas Wilson Dorr, attorney of law in the state of Rhode Island, 1842. What we are fighting for and trying to accomplish is just change our state charter, which is disenfranchising the majority of white eligible voters in the state of Rhode Island. I vow to run for governor this year in 1842 against Sammy Ward King, the incumbent, who vowed to keep that charter in place. And I vow to change it to allow all free men the right to vote, regardless of their worth. Governor King, the incumbent, Sammy Ward King, refuses to acknowledge this vote and refuses to allow me to take my seat. Unfortunately, he has declared martial law against me to prevent me from doing so and has put a warrant out for my arrest. At this time, I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but I vow to fight it. We vow to take it in our possession, those two candidates, and the governorship of the state of Rhode Island, peacefully if we can, forcefully if we must. Majority of our weapons, cannon in tow and muskets, misfired, failed due to the high humidity of the air. And unfortunately, I've sent my troops back to Chepachet, the safety of my headquarters at Sprague's Tavern, and also to fortify the hill, Eight Goats Hill Cemetery, with cannon perched upon every point. As a result of the cannons left behind, as Governor Dorr disbanded his army at Eight Goats Hill Cemetery, boys of Gloucester, several teenagers in the town of Gloucester, took advantage of the cannons left behind and the arsenal and ammunition and began firing upon over the hill into the town. And that led to the misperception that the Dorr Rebellion battle actually started and commenced in the town of Chepachet. Governor Dorr eventually returned to Rhode Island to face the charges of treason and fought in court against them. He unfortunately was found guilty of treason and was sent to life in prison and hard labor for the rest of his life. During the time Governor Dorr spent in jail, which was approximately 1 year, the charter was eventually changed to allow all free men the right to vote over the age of 21 as long as you would afford $1 poll tax, signed by Governor Sammy Ward King, the incumbent, who he fought against for several years. Governor Dorr's legacy still lives today as a result of the Dorr Museum in the state of Rhode Island, town of Chepachet, at Eight Goats Hill Cemetery at the Dr. Wilbur Mason House, will be the Dorr Rebellion Museum, a place where all visitors and tourists alike can visit to learn about his history, or go to the Tavern on Main, where Sprague's Tavern is still standing today, Governor Dorr's headquarters, 1842. Thank you.
My first day here, I wanted
to be in the engineering program. Like, I walked into the engineering room my freshman year and I was like, this is the place where I'm supposed to be.
At Ponegansett High School, we created the STEM Academy to give students many unique opportunities to develop their skills and then use that to go into college and careers.
I choose more STEM Academy classes because there's more hands-on work and you're actually like creating a 3D object in reality, not on a piece of paper.
We're unique for a reason that we have three different pathways. We have a pre-engineering pathway, a materials and manufacturing pathway, and a computer science and information technology pathway that offers students different opportunities in these specific areas.
There is a lot more hands-on activities, and you feel like you're engaged in the curriculum rather than just being taught it and not seeing where it applies to real life.
The education that we're providing both captures the value of our communities, but also prepares our kids with the 21st century skills they're going to need to be successful in college and careers.
You are much more engaged in what you are learning. Like, this isn't put an equation on the board, memorize it, take a test on it. You are applying what you learn here.
Also at the Ponegansett STEM Academy, we've created a first FRC team, which competed in its rookie year last year. The great thing about the FRC robotics team is that it gives students the opportunity in a very intense environment to hone their skills and to develop skills that they can use in business and in college.
The three pathways that we set up for the STEM Academy help FRC in many ways because materials and manufacturing help manufacture the robot, computer science and information technology help program the robot, and the engineering will design.
You walk into a competition, and I was not expecting this big room full of people rooting for robots to throw a ball like 7 feet into the air.
It was really exciting to be in a room full of people that were enthusiastic about engineering and building something that worked and working as a team.
I remember being a little kid, like hearing about like building a robot, it just seemed like such a foreign, impossible task to do. And then you go there and you see all these robots that were built just by the normal kids. It's really inspiring.
The Ponegansett STEM Academy offers hands-on learning, which is a great combination of theory that we learn in class and then practical application, or the practice of doing all of these activities.
I'm excited to take the skills that I've learned in my engineering classes and use them in the real world.
I'm excited about the software engineering courses that are going to be put in and the rest of the computer science curriculum.
Not only did I learn about trebuchets and gravity and all the different aspects related to trebuchets, but I learned more about being a leader and standing up for myself, especially being a girl in engineering, because there's not a lot of them.
We must prepare them with a rigorous academic preparation, but also that whole child, that ability to work on a team, that ability to solve problems, that ability to collaborate, the recognition that you need to produce items with precision and accuracy, that the quality of your work matters, the timeliness of your submissions matter, and how well you contributed to with other members of your team all matter to your success.
There's been times where I've hated going to school, but the fact that I can go into my engineering class or my STEM class makes me want to go to school. It's one of the brightest parts of my day.
We've been entering floats in the 4th of July parade since 1979, and we've been in 36 parades. And during those years, we won best of the parade in most of all of those years.
When we did celebrate the holidays, we had to pick a holiday for every person. And I studied biology and wildlife in college, so I always liked doing animals, so I picked Groundhog's Day.
Elephant Day is a big deal in Chepachet, because in 1826, an elephant was shot in town. We built an elephant, and I was the elephant slayer. And as the float went down the street, it was my job to continually shoot that elephant. And the elephant's name is Little Bet, and my name is Betty. So I feel close to the elephant. The parade is really a family affair. All of us get together and decide on a theme. It's
Kenny,
a secret. We have a secret meeting with secret minutes, and we don't let the theme out to anybody in the public.
It's a
My brother Ken is amazing. He can just take a piece of metal, weld something to it, put wire on it, turn it into an animal.
He can create anything. He turns trash into treasure.
I'm the float artist, and I put all the facial features and all the fur and feathers and to make the animal look real. As we're coming down the parade route, there's people lined on both sides of the street. Our music is blasting out of the speakers coming out of the front of the truck. We also have another sound system on the truck itself, so sometimes we play multiple songs, but the people are cheering, they're clapping.
The crowd pumps us up, they get us ready. They're cheering, they're clapping, they're yelling, jumping, dancing with the music, and it really gets us, you know, more into our role.
For many of the themes that we've chosen, my role has been to be up on top of the truck, maybe on some type of a pipe. I was the Grinch, and when we did Tis the Season, I was Puss in Boots, and I was riding up just underneath the telephone poles, riding on a dragon with its wings flapping.
2 years ago, I was a skunk in the parade we did, Having a Bad Day. And I was just walking down the street. I had a little squirt bottle that I would pretend to spray people with, or I would walk down the road and then just fall and pretend to be roadkill. So I thought that was really having a bad day.
I got to play Indiana Jones, which was one of the funnest roles I've ever played. My brother made a hill and then a gigantic rock out of papier mache. And being Indiana Jones, of course, I had to avoid the rock coming down the hill. It would roll down the hill, and then I had to jump down into a hole just as the rock went over my head. And I did that over and over and over and over again, all the way down the parade route. And it was so much fun. Our earliest floats was just a truck. The whole length of the float is 125 feet. And all the family gets involved. Even my grandmother, who was 77 in her first float, she was a queen bee, and she was a pirate, and she just really enjoyed being in the parade.
We're sworn to secrecy. We don't let anything out.
Whatever the float will be, it is a secret until it actually comes rolling down the street on 4th of July, 2015.
My wife and I have bought a big old farm out here in Chepachet, Rhode Island. We have close to 40 acres, and we're very excited. We bought the Andrew Brown homestead, where we have beautiful rolling hills, and we have the ability to plant some great grapes out here. The uniqueness about this 300-year-old farm is that it's in probably some of the best soils in Rhode Island. It's an outwash plain, and all the top loam was dumped by glaciation back in the day. Good soil is going to give you a good grapevine, and the warm days and cool nights are going to bring the sugar level up with the grapes, and the cool nights will bring the acids down, so it's going to make a really nice grape. So we have the potential to plant anywhere from 10 to 20 acres here in Rhode Island. One of my good friends described it as a field of sticks. And I think that's a funny statement, but it's true. If you plant 5 grapevines in a row, you expect them to all do the same. If they have all the same nutrition, water, but they just don't. Sometimes 4 will do great, and that one just will never make it. So you have to pull it out and replant. Throughout the season, it's pretty exciting to see the grapevines come up from little shoots to get the little baby clusters and the leaves to midway through the season, you can't even control the growth. You have to prune them back, you have to make sure the leaves are away from the grapes so they get even photo exposure. If you let one side sit in the sun all day, you'll find that you'll get burn on those grapes. And one side of the berry will be perfectly ripe and the other side won't. If you plant north to south, what will happen in north to south, the sun will come up and evenly hit the berries on both sides. You come along and you prune them and they'll all be on the cordon wires. So it's very straightforward and very easy to prune. So these are in 36-pound lugs, that's what they call them. And we put them on the back of the tractor and we pull them in. And then we bring it up here to the winery. Whether it's a white wine, we press it right away. If it's a red wine, we let it sit on the skins. We add the yeast into the primary fermentation tank with some nutrients and other magic. And then we press it off after about 14 days. I think the hardest part is the cleaning, is making sure everything is sterile and clean. So we use a blend of two different types of sterilization. We use what they call soda ash to make sure that it's sterile. And we use citric acid, which basically comes from lemons and makes sure that that's pretty safe. Especially if you're using plastic, what happens is the plastic will get pitted and it'll get stained. There's always residual bacteria in there and you want to make sure you're always ahead of the bacteria. You want to keep it clean so that you get a good wine and it doesn't impart any spoilage. And this is called Gemi Noir, and we're gonna be pressing them and de-stemming them today. We're gonna be making a rosé or a blush wine, so it'll be a nice wine for the summer next year. So it takes a little while. It's probably gonna sit in our stainless steel tank for approximately 6 to 8 months.
Look at this cluster. Holy cow, look at this one. That's great.
Good out.
Bacterial spoilage and gives the yeast more of the advantage. So we're looking at probably about 11%. Ready?
Yep.
You do blush duty? the bladder expands, it pushes the grapes and the skins against it, and it starts to drizzle right out into the catch basin. It goes right into the bucket.
I like planting, I like taking care of the grapes. Selling is fun too, you get to meet a lot of new people, but everyone's a little bit different. Some people just want to come in and drink, and other people want to hang out and learn the story and share their stories.
So this is our Riesling, our first release. You'll notice it's nice, crisp, and refreshing. It's not too sweet like most Riesling, and it's not too dry like a German Riesling.
It's refreshing. It's something you can drink on a hot summer's day. It's something that you can still curl up by a fire and enjoy in the wintertime. So it's very universal. It's fun. I try not to tell them what they're tasting because everyone kind of interprets things differently. But it's always interesting to see what the next person tastes.
And then we'll bottle it and put a label on it and sell it at the winery. Delicious.
Hey Joel, how are you?
Most of my friends love coming out for the press because after a red wine press, you have to sample it to make sure it's good.
What do you think?
Yeah.
It's gonna be good, right?
Yeah.
Just remember that West Gloucester is a very important part of the town, even if we don't have a post office here anymore. We have a lot of families that still live here, that have been here for more than 200 years. Hayfields, cow pastures, woodlots, a lot of pine trees, and country. It's definitely rural. We had wonderful summers and we took it for granted that we could come and were here and family was here to look after us. We didn't get out very far away from the house. There's a little building out back that we had for a playhouse because my grandmother didn't want us cluttering up the house with our nonsense. I spent a lot of time here with my grandparents when my mother was working. My mother ended up at Classical High School, class of 1914, which turned out to be a very interesting group of people. Interesting for my children to know because they grew up in a world before the First World War, and by the time they had their 70th reunion in 1984, man had walked on the moon. So that it was a very interesting group of people to know. They had seen so much change in the world. My mother was able to go to Brown. It used to be the Woman's College at Brown, then later on it was Pembroke. Now it's the Women's College at Brown again. And she was class of 1918. Spent 1 year at Columbia Teachers College. Did all the work to get a master's from Columbia, but she would have had to pay $100 for the degree, so she never actually got her master's from Columbia, even though she had all the credits. She came back, she had a master's from Brown. If you got to eighth grade, that was considered an education. She was fairly innovative and obviously a leader in her generation. People had cemeteries on their own property because that was the only practical way to deal with a difficult situation. Because we've been able to live in the same area all these years, our cemetery is here. And we have the first cemetery as a little girl was buried in 1793, and the most recent grave is a little girl that would have been my great-granddaughter, and she died very recently. And we have grandparents, aunts, uncles, several generations ever since the house was built about 1791, but it's important to maintain the area and the respect for the people that came before you. One of her favorite quotes was, in studying a lot of history, it's terribly important to know about your ancestors so that you don't go through life believing you were self-made.
I came with my grandmother every summer from as soon as we were out of school to the day before we went back. You're chasing frogs, turtles, everything else. No, I loved it. I still love it. I mean, that's why I'm still here. As my father put it, we destroy the real estate statistics. Every house sells every 6 years, and this one hasn't sold in 225. And they laid out the road, northwest, southwest, number of degrees, surveyed it, number of poles, and then submitted it to the Gloucester Town Council, who met December 1785, viewed it, and accepted it. I feel I'm a caretaker of the archives. Charlie is my, to use my father's words, first child of my blood. And the best way I could describe that is Charlie, when we're doing anything around here, the people I'm working with goes, boy, she wants to work. And so the reality is, that's what she learns from me. I'm a very firm believer in the Indian tradition that we borrow this land from the future generations, so it's not mine. It's mine to look out for.
On the other side of town, the sun is going down.
I'm like a transplant. I came up from North Carolina, and I've been here ever since. There wasn't many houses on this road at that time. I thought it was the end of the world when I found out. And the road, 94, you know, it was a dirt road. I think this place is just, it's something that grows on you or something, I don't know, because I remember when you first brought me up here and down there where I live, and I said, oh my God, and I found out there are no bus transportation. Then I found out you could get a bus down on the pike and go into Providence for 8 o'clock in the morning, and you could come back at 5 o'clock. Well, I used to go down there and wander around the stores, and I made a lot of friends, and I haven't been here too long, but I made a lot of friends. I said, I don't know. I said, they're cold in there. I said, you know what I think? I said, I think that wherever you go, you find whatever you're looking for. I think it's become home.
It It was my mother-in-law and father-in-law's. They started it in 1929 as a little diner. They brought two trolley cars in and set it up. One was the diner, one was the restaurant. And this is a picture of my husband when he was a little boy, and his father and mother. Skip's 85 now. A couple of years later, they added on, put a dining room, a little tap room, and a little sunroom, and the family lived there. We took it over in 1964, and we were there for 41 years. When we first opened it up, it was like a meeting place, the diner. They'd come in, the fellas, you know, and have their coffee and three or four or five Phillips and talk about the town gossip. My sons worked there, my granddaughters worked there, everybody in the family. One thing they learned was not to be afraid of hard work, because there's one thing about a restaurant, it's 24/7 and, you know, 7 days a week. The odd day you go off shopping and picking up things that you need for the business. So they've got a good work ethic. When we had the cat, we met more people used to come for the summer. They had cottages up at Echo Lake or Bowdish, and it's really a killer when you get people come in and say, oh, my grandmother used to bring me here, my grandfather used to bring me here, and now I'm seeing the fourth generation, and I think, how old am I? I still run into people all the time. Rose, we miss you, we miss you. And I said, well, that's the only part of it we miss, is the people. We had such wonderful, faithful customers. It was a landmark. Everybody'd say, oh, we'll meet you in front of the Purple Cat, or you turn right at the Purple Cat, or everything was the Purple Cat.
I'm Carol Fry, formerly Morin, and I want to tell you about my father, who was a one-man police department here in Chepachet many years ago. He was appointed chief of police in 1937 and served till 1941. And then after that, he was appointed again in 1950 and served until 1970. During that time, he was also the town sergeant, which involved serving summonses and calls to court. But the thing I remember, especially in the early first many years of the 20, he was a chief when I was a child, was that he did all his police business on the kitchen table, because there was no formal police department. So he would do his paperwork there at the kitchen table. And on Saturday nights, he'd get all dressed up in his uniform and he would tour around the town and check all the bar rooms and make sure that there were no fights going on. And then he'd come home. The state police had a presence in town, and they took care of the major highways. So Dad's job was just pretty much keeping the hot rodders off the street as best as he could, because we all know how teenagers like to drive, and serving summons. And as he said, it was only a few hours job. He received $100 a month as chief of police and put in about 8 hours. And he said here, for that kind of money, you can't go real strong, you know. And that sounds just like my dad. I could hear him saying that. And I always thought he looked so spiffy when he got done up in his uniform and went out. I mean, we could never do anything on Saturday evenings because Dad had to always make the rounds, but it was a good time. A smallish man who always would get in trouble with his wife, and many, many nights I can remember him coming and knocking on the door and asking for my father's help with the wife and hit him with the frying pan again. So Dad would take him home and talk him back into the house and things would settle down. But I don't remember any other really difficult things. He was a pretty easygoing guy, and he always seemed to be able to see the humor in most situations. I have only good memories of my dad. I had the utmost respect and love for him. I mean, he was my best friend, and he had the best sense of humor of anyone I ever met.
It's kind of hard to explain, because, you know, when you're out there, it's like total tranquility. From end to end, it's probably almost 2 miles, not even, mile and a half. There's a couple little coves, an awesome sandbar where everybody goes to and anchors up. You know, if you don't know them, it doesn't matter. They're just as happy as you. A lot of fish. Bass, an attitude, because they're too smart out here now. You know, I mean, me and my girlfriend, we fish almost every other day, and I'm either catching a buzz or an attitude. It's yeah, but the main thing is you can go out there and fish, you know, and whether you're catching anything or not, I still come out with a smile. It's hard to get me off this lake in the summer for like a party or, you know, graduation or whatnot. Not pretty. You know, especially, you know, if it's hot and, you know, and you gotta sit in a yard, I'll get claustrophobic. You know, this is my yard. I've never had to mow a lawn ever in my life.
And that's Our Town Glocester, a look at this historic, close-knit community through the eyes of its residents and friends.
Handcrafted wines, one wine at a time. Mulberry Vineyards, located in historic Chepachet, Rhode Island.